Good morning, Lighthouse Christian Church. My name is Joe. I'm glad that you could join us for this morning's service. I'm one of the pastors here, and I want to go through some announcements before we continue on with our worship and song. Just a few announcements here. First, we will be partaking of communion later in our service today. So you'll want to have some juice and bread or crackers nearby. This is the first Sunday of the month, and we typically celebrate and observe communion on the first Sunday of the month. So if you don't have those ready, get them ready now. It's a good time. Second thing here, after service today at 11:15 a.m., we invite you to join us for a time of prayer as we seek God's healing and restoration in light of recent events. And we had a great time at our Justice Forum this past Thursday, as well as a time of prayer a week ago on Sunday. And we're gonna invite you, we invite you again this morning at 11:15 after the service is done to pray with us, to seek God's healing, his restoration, in light of the injustice that we've been seeing the last couple of weeks. Please look for the Zoom invitation in the chat box or on our website to join us. Third thing here, Lighthouse has decided to continue supporting the Jubilee Reach Grocery Program through August 24th due to the financial impact of COVID-19. And while some families no longer need assistance, our Jubilee Reach, our ministry partner here in the Bellevue area, hopes to meet the needs of additional families. We are so grateful for those of you who have been contributing monetarily and also giving of your time, buying groceries. So we're so grateful that you have been obedient to the call that God has laid on your hearts. We are seeking now, as we are going to extend the program, for more volunteers and people to give of their time and of their donations. Please check our website on how to volunteer, and we'll have more information on our website there. I invite you at this point to participate in worshiping with your tithes and or your offerings by writing and mailing a check or by giving online. All of the information, if you go to our website, lighthousechristian.church, there's a button on that website that says give, and go ahead and do that. At this point, I would like to pray for us, and I'd like to pray specifically for Lighthouse people and all the things that we've been seeing, all the racial injustice and so much turmoil in our country. I want to pray for us. I want to pray for those of you who call Lighthouse your home. And would you join me in prayer? Let me pray. Lord, I pray for Lighthouse people. God, there is so much that we still need to learn about love, about injustice, about our own prejudices, about our own racism, about the things, Lord, that exist in us that are not aligned with who you are and how you want us to treat and to love our brothers and our sisters. Father, I pray that you would give us a humble heart, that you would allow us to examine our hearts, that you would allow you to examine our hearts and to search our hearts. Father, we pray that as a people that we would have compassion, that we would have empathy and take next steps, Lord, to understand the pain of our brothers and our sisters. Lord, your word tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. And Lord, our brothers and our sisters in the African American community, Lord, they are hurting. And it's undeniable, Lord, the pain that they're going through and the hurts that they're going through. And it's not just of recent events, Lord. It's just been mounting and building up. And God, while we may not understand what's going on or how they are feeling, Father, we pray that you would help us to take seriously the charge in the scriptures to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. Our African American brothers and sisters are weeping. They are hurting. They are in turmoil. So Father, help us. There is still so much for us to learn about your love, about your grace, and about your mercy. Father, teach us as your people to love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to sing a song called The Blessing, and the lyrics are based on a few blessings from Scripture. But this morning, I invite you to pray this song over the Black community that's in so much pain right now. God is always on the side of justice. God always lines up with the vulnerable and the oppressed and champions the full image of God, humanity in each person. So Lighthouse, let's sing this blessing as an affirmation of God's heart for our Black brothers, sisters, and non-binary siblings, and as a prayer that our own hearts and lives would reflect this heart of God. Together, the Lord bless you.
May his presence go before you and behind. The mighty mountains. Join me in prayer. Father God, we come before you in the name of your Son Jesus in need, recognizing that we come from different places this week, some hurting, some stress, with a lot of things going on in the world and in our hearts. Lord, we need you. And so we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would help our hearts hear what you want us to hear. I pray that you would help me to speak the words you want me to say. We commit this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning. My name is Trenton, one of the pastors here, and I have the privilege of bringing the message this morning. The title is Doing Hard Things Takes More Than Good Intentions. Erica and I, my beautiful bride Erica and I, met when we were 16 and 17 years old, and we were married at the age of 21. And however healthy our marriage is now, it honestly hasn't always been that way. Because when you say I do, it isn't the end of the story, it's actually just the beginning. It's required, honestly, more than of me than I would have ever known in that moment of I do. Each day is a decision to love, to work on us, to put her needs above my own. And as you can imagine, sometimes that happens, and sadly, many times it doesn't. During some of the years, it felt like we weren't even going to make it at all. And I wonder if some of you guys that are married can resonate with that. When I think about my Christian life as a whole, there are a lot of things that I feel like I've done okay. There's a few things that I think I've done, you know, pretty well, and then there's a whole bunch of things where I feel like a complete failure. Some things feel like they're hard, others seem like they come easily for some reason. Some of the day-to-day things, frankly, seem harder than the big tasks. And then there are the things that I think God wants me to do, and much of the thoughts that I have and that come to mind are ones of doubt and uncertainty, fears and questions, really centering around whether I have the ability to do it or not. I think it's part of the human condition that we flip from one form of pride to another, believing I can take care of it all, or thinking I can't do anything, placing too much confidence in ourselves, or not having enough confidence to believe that we can accomplish even the simplest of tasks. Sometimes for me, I just don't want to fail. So what I do is I busy myself and with things that make me and others believe like I'm doing enough already. Sometimes the task just seems so overwhelming and daunting that honestly, I don't even know if it's possible, and then I kind of just do the same thing. Other times I think I can, come to find out that I really can't, and then I fail, followed most of the time by this idea that I don't want to put myself out again and fail again, so I don't want to even try. Sometimes the difficulty is that I feel so overwhelmed with what's going on around me and what's going on inside of me that I don't know what to do. When I was thinking about this, it happened when my grandfather passed away. He was my mom's dad. He was the last of my grandparents to die. None of them knew Jesus, weren't Christian. And afterwards, I felt a lot of guilt and a lot of shame and a lot of anger and a lot of sadness. I couldn't share about Jesus with them anymore. I couldn't pray for them to know him. I couldn't call to say hi and I love you. I was just kind of left sad, kind of in a pit of despair. And the hardest thing for me at the time was just to move forward. Ask me to share Jesus with someone I don't know, and inside I'm completely freaking out. Ask me to move my family to another continent and country, and sure, no problem. I don't know why some things come easy and some things are hard. I don't know how that works. During this time of COVID, I know that all of us are experiencing some form of change or difficulty or stress. Maybe it's for you work stress. Maybe you don't have work. Maybe there's financial issues and and problems that are going on that are just out of your control. Many of us have relational challenges, either too much relationship. We're with our families 24/7, and some of it's too little, where you feel isolated and alone. Think to yourself and maybe raise your hand in your own mind if you feel like you need a break, because I think in some ways we all do. Do the words stress eating mean anything to anyone? Chips and donuts are disappearing in my household at a level that I'm sure there's a local business that's benefiting somewhere. Isolation leads to anxiety and depression. Fear is rampant. Uncertainty is all over the place, and no one really knows when it's going to end. And at least some of us folks so focused on surviving, we barely even know what day it is, let alone feel we're on mission for Jesus and knowing what he wants for us and living on purpose. And then there are events of the last couple weeks, which has brought for many of us a level of anger and sadness and grief and despair and hopelessness that's so overwhelming that we don't even know where to turn. A sense that something needs to be done, but are at a loss for what to do and how to do it, and whether we feel like we have the ability to do whatever it is we're supposed to be doing. A couple weeks ago, another black man died at the hands of a white police officer. Now, before you all get all up in arms about, you know, what I'm about to say, it's not political, and I'm not gonna make a political statement. It's just reality. George Floyd was killed, 8:46. Does anyone know what those numbers mean? 8:46. 8 minutes and 46 seconds of an officer's knee on the back of George Floyd's neck. 2:53. 2 minutes and 53 seconds of an officer's knee on the back of George Floyd's neck after he was already unconscious. Now, I don't know what your response has been. Mine has been anger and outrage, mostly internal, because that's kind of how I process. Sadness. Maybe some of us are indifferent. We're just not certain about what to think. And some of us just want to learn and understand and have questions. I don't know where this time in history lands for you. But I want us to think about a few things as we continue this morning. When Moses returned to Egypt, God demanded to Pharaoh to let my people go, to release them from slavery and bondage, where they were property, and Pharaoh's wealth and power was being built on the backs of their lives. And God, who's rich in mercy and grace, delivered them from oppression. Our country has an interesting history. Several hundred years ago, Africans were brought here as slaves, and the country was built upon their labor, and many people's prosperity was built at the expense of their lives as property. And then even as slavery was abolished, they weren't really free because it became illegal to be unemployed even though they couldn't get jobs, the punishment of which was labor again. Laws were passed to keep them separate from whites, separate but equal, we've been told, separate but less than and inferior in reality. They couldn't live in certain areas. Some of you of different, you know, ethnic backgrounds can remember times in the Seattle area where your ancestors and your family, your genealogy was only allowed to buy property in certain places, not around whites. They could only have certain jobs, and they couldn't have certain jobs. They were uneducated, and laws were passed to keep them from voting. And even as much as progress has happened in the subsequent years, and no one's denying that, people of color are stopped by the police at a far higher rate, sentenced more harshly for the exact same crimes, and killed at the hands of officers at a rate disproportionate to their percentage of the population. Now imagine if those were your people. Imagine if George Floyd was your son, your brother, or your dad. If you're watching and you are a person of Asian descent, since coronavirus, which some people call the Chinese virus, has come around, you've gone out in public and you've been looked at with suspicion. Not because you're carrying a virus, not because of anything but ignorance based on someone's perception of your skin color and your ethnic background. And 3 months, 3 months that's happened. And some of us have experienced that. And it's a glimpse for 3 months what's happened in this country for hundreds of years. And for an African American man and woman, what happens to them every day. Now, in God's eyes, in God's kingdom, according to his scripture and what he's revealed to us in his word, Jesus came and removed the boundary lines of race, gender, and class in creating a new people, his family. So when something happens to one, it actually happens to all as your own family and as yourself. And maybe we live too much in an independent kind of isolated time that we see ourselves as separated from our people, that we can see even when it happens to someone that we know or tangentially that we can ignore it. But make no mistake that what God is creating isn't what Jesus has provided is not a religion so that my individual self-centered self can go see God in heaven when I die. He came to create a people of which we're a part of and a body of which we are all one. As a Christian, and which by all accounts George Floyd seems to be, he was your brother. He was your family. And so is every black man and woman who calls the name of Jesus. And regardless of faith, all are image bearers of God and worthy of honor, the honor and respect and dignity associated with this most significant designation. I won't pretend that this is, we're not going to pretend like this is the only thing going on in the world or in your lives. And some of us are not as aware or distraught over this time. And it's not meant to make us feel guilty about bringing it up or guilty that you can't spend enough time thinking about it or praying about it. And I'm not going to insist that we feel a certain way. But many of us, myself included, need to recognize and repent of the ways that we dismiss things that aren't close to us and don't affect us, things we deem happening to other people. And as followers of Jesus, it can't be that way. That isn't God's instruction to us. That isn't Jesus' modeling for us. It isn't what Jesus came for. We need to recognize that many people are hurting. Many are at the end of themselves. Many are wanting to do the right thing and don't know what that is and don't know if we have what it takes. And so, wherever you are this morning, physically, literally, or emotionally and inside, if you've been experiencing hard times or you feel like, you know, there's something that you're needing to do or that you're wanting to do that's hard, this morning, I think God has something to say to us. And this morning, I have some good news and I have some bad news. If you're like me, I just want the bad news first to kind of get it out of the way and then kind of move on. The first is the bad news. Doing hard things is going to take more than good intentions. In this time, in your life right now and in the future, doing hard things is going to take more than good intentions. And then we're going to transition and we're going to look at this idea that the good news. That Jesus resolves to do God's will despite the costs. And we'll get to why that's good and how that's tied together. But first, let me read today's passage, Matthew 26, 31 through 46. Jesus told them, "This very night you will all fall away on account of me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered." It's a quote out of Zechariah. "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Peter replied, "Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will." "Truly, I tell you," Jesus answered, "this very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. But Peter declared, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the other disciples said the same thing. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over and pray." So he leaves the group of disciples. And then in verse 37, he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, along with him. And he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell on his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet, not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." The disciples fail despite good intentions. Even if everyone falls away, "I won't," says Peter. How many of you have made declarations of commitment and change and allegiance only to find that you couldn't or wouldn't follow through pretty soon afterwards? If you've ever wrestled with sin like anger or lust or pride, this is probably a pretty familiar pattern to you, as it is me. "I'm never going to do it again. I swear, God, just help me and I won't do it again." And then it happens again, and then you pray, you ask for forgiveness, and then you say, "I'm sorry, Lord, I won't do it again." Again. Peter and the disciples are following Jesus. They're committed to him, but at the same time, they're unaware of what it's actually going to take and what the response is going to be in their time of testing. And we come to this understanding of this truth as we watch them, that doing hard things takes more than good intentions. We see Jesus ask Peter, James, and John to come with him as he is overwhelmed and he's sorrowful and he needs to talk with his Father. "Come with me," he says. "Be with me. Support me in my time of need." Their response? They take a nap. They essentially deserted him in his time of distress. The next time he leaves them with instructions to pray and watch that they not fall into temptation. Their response? They fall asleep. A third time, watch and pray. And a third time, taking a nap again. When in the following chapters, Jesus is arrested, Peter is asked if he's one of the followers. And three times he denies that he even knows Jesus. And in the end, all of the disciples flee and scatter. All of the disciples fail, despite their good intentions. Jesus tells them to pray because though the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. And I have to imagine that that means something for us today, that of all of the good intentions that we have, sometimes things we get to and many times we don't, promises that we make and then really never keep. Some of us are left to wonder and doubt whether we can do or accomplish anything in the way of God's purposes in this world. We wonder in some ways in the back of our mind for all that posturing and commitment and declaration, if we'll just kind of flicker out like a candle whose wick has been completely burned down. Promises, declarations, "I won't leave you," "Stay with me while I am in need," fall asleep three times, deny and scatter. Contrast this with Jesus. What we see in him is a resolve to do God's will despite the cost. His instruction to pray and his praying himself demonstrate that the Lord's prayer was his own. This resolve is rooted deeply in his relationship to prayer and to God. "Father, deliver us, lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Your will be done." What the disciples don't do, Jesus lives out. And as he prays, we see something about who he is that for me personally has broadened and deepened my understanding of who Jesus is, where he is in my pain and my hurt, how he loves me and how much he loves this world. His prayers, his speaking to God are real. They're honest prayer that he may not have to do the very thing that he's been speaking about through his 3 years of ministry, what he feels like he is born and brought here to do, what he was sent for. We see the humanity of Jesus, a picture of him, not as a teacher, though he is wise, not as a prophet, though he continues to speak God's word, not yet as the risen Lord, and not the one at the end of time that will judge and vanquish evil. We see in the garden, as he's sweating tears of blood, someone who wrestles, someone who feels, someone who experiences, someone who anguishes, and then commits himself to his Father and to you and to me. Sorrow and anguish to the point of death, sadness and heartache and despair to the point where one would say, it's killing me. The anguish is over the cup, the suffering and the death, the judgment, the consequences of sin, the injustice of evil that he's going to take on himself. In the scripture, there's allusion to this picture of it being a picture of a king with a huge goblet or a huge chalice overflowing with strong wine and alcohol and spices, stuff of which we want in some ways, and we want to turn to. But when it's referred to in this way, the picture is that we're made to drink of it all at once, just dump down your throat, and then you walk away in this stupor, in some ways punished by the consequences of what you wanted, going your own way in sin and pride and idolatry. The consequences of the sins of the world are taken upon himself so that we, as his people, would be released from having to take it on ourselves. Why were God's people at the time led into exile in the Old Testament? Essentially, they didn't worship God. More particularly, they didn't live for righteousness and justice. Their religious practices and their lives were full of idolatry. They allowed someone else besides God to determine right and wrong, how to live. Do we sacrifice children? Do we be the light to the world? And then God poured his judgment out on them from the north, and they went into captivity. What was Jesus' indictment of the leadership in chapter 23 of this book of Matthew? You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of justice, mercy, and faithfulness. This time that Jesus is wrestling with was going to deal not just with the wrongs of Israel. Jesus was looking forward to the cross, to the taking on the sins of the world. Selfishness and pride, the consequences of which are sexual slavery, indentured slavery, oppression, treating people like property and or objects. The setting is the Mount of Olives. And the Mount of Olives is, if you think about where the city of Jerusalem is on the top near the Temple Mount, and you go east down through the Kidron Valley and then up onto the Mount of Olives, that's where the Garden of Gethsemane is. And you can visit today. Some of the trees are extremely old and not all of them are there, but you get an idea of the kind of the atmosphere and environment that this particular scene Jesus would find himself in, the Mount of Olives. And olives during that time and this time, but more particularly during that time, made olive oil for food, for lamps and for anointing, food that brought nourishment, lamps that provided light, anointing that ushered in the ministry of a priest as well as was used in prayer for healing. Priests were anointed, the sick were anointed. Oil was placed in lamps so that people could see in the dark. oil was eaten, olives were eaten for nourishment. But in order to produce the life-giving oil, it had to go through a process of being crushed. And you can look up pictures of how you take an olive and make it into olive oil. You have to crush it. And if you read about it, there's different numbers of crushing. And many think that they're referring to the crushing of three times. Jesus came to the Father the first time. If it's possible. He knows what he's going to face. He knows why he's born, why he was sent, his whole purpose for living. And yet he doesn't want to do it because he knows what it's going to cost. If it's possible. And then the statement, not my will, but your will be done. That was the first one. In the second, if it's not possible, your will be done. An acceptance that this is the way that it needs to be. And a beginning to see the resolve of what it is that Jesus is going to decide the second time. And the third time, the same, the declaration that your will be done. We see just a glimpse of what Jesus faced in the garden and what he understood would come. The cross, the cost of bringing God's kingdom into this world, the thing that we long for, the shalom of God that would make all things right, that we can experience now because of his life being offered and taking upon him all that we deserve, including this idea that is hard to understand, that God the Father turned his face from him, which some argue is the ultimate punishment that he endured. This resolve of Jesus in doing hard things, despite the cost, that we see in prayer, and we also see in relationship. We get to see the depth of Jesus' devotion to his Father and his love for you. He models for us prayer and devotion, love, all despite the costs. And in the end, we see very, very clearly that Jesus understands the hurt and the pain and the grief that the world has, and he's overcome it. He understands the hurt, the pain, the grief in your life, and he's overcome it all. As post-resurrection Christians, we can look back into this account and see the fingerprint of a sovereign God at work. Jesus predicts Peter's response, which is fulfilled later on when he denies knowing who he is. Jesus knows that all of biblical history is leading up to this point, and even before he dies and is raised again, tells them, which they understandably completely miss, that he'll see them after he rises in Galilee, when he's reunited with his friends. First, after he's resurrected, but also after they fail. God is sovereignly at work in the most trying times in the midst of the chaos and injustice that ensues, which leads to his trial and his crucifixion. What is happening all around them is not all that is happening. What they see with their eyes is not all that there is. This relationship you see kind of come out in a different and significant way. And I hope we pay attention to this. What comes in the following chapters is the restoration of the disciples, his friends, his followers. Their failure, despite protestation that will never happen, somehow doesn't prevent Jesus from seeing them as the plan to bring the message of hope to the world. Not a plan amongst others, but the plan to usher in the kingdom and his message. The same people who fell asleep during his time of distress, who didn't pray to keep themselves from temptation as he knew they should, but instead took a nap, not once, not twice, but three times, and in the end, all deserted him in his time of need. These are the ones he restores, who become the leaders of the church that you and I are now a part of, as a worldwide family of God and of Jesus' followers. Maybe we can identify with the failures of the witnesses or the disciples and the weaknesses of the disciples. Maybe you have good intentions in an area of your life, and at the same time, you're not sure whether you're going to be able to follow through. Maybe you're heartened by this idea, as I am, that Jesus understands the anguish that you are experiencing, have experienced, or will experience. And you can cry right alongside him, as in the garden, knowing that the suffering, challenges, evil that we see in this world and we experience right now is the consequence of the very thing that he took upon himself, sin. And that he resolved nonetheless to do the very thing that he didn't want to do, which is offer his life for us, taking on all of that punishment because he loves you. If you consider yourself a follower of Jesus, we are the people of God. You are the people of God, charged with being his representatives here on earth. In a world that is not as it's supposed to be, we as the church are to advance the kingdom of righteousness and justice so that as we embody in ourselves the upside-down kingdom, others will see and experience the goodness of God and come to know this King who has laid down his life so that we can experience true life. Justice and righteousness, from God's perspective, is not just making sure that people are treated well. It's not just having the right laws, though those are important. Those don't come anywhere close to addressing the core issues of evil, prejudice, racism, and hate in our world. For as we know, when we look inside of ourselves, when we look out into the world, and when we read in Scripture, this truth is glaringly obvious, that our hearts are deceitfully wicked above all else. That even with good intentions, we can't even follow through. So external fixes, though they're essential, are not the end of the story for Jesus and his people. It's just not. And I don't want us as followers of Jesus to settle for anything other than what God wants for this world and for us. Jesus didn't wrestle with whether to take the cup so that people would not hurt each other and be nice and then have laws that force us to do so. Laws, though essential, are just completely inadequate. Justice and righteousness is not the absence of conflict or the appearance of peace, but the presence of shalom, God's ways. And in Jesus, we can experience that here and now in this life, albeit in part, but then one day in full, as we look forward to a time where his kingdom is experienced in its fullness, where there is no weeping and there is no sadness and there is no suffering. God's grace and truth represented in Christ is the only way to enter into and advance this kingdom, of which Isaiah says, of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time and forever. May we continue through our weaknesses and our failures to pursue life God's way, encouraged by this truth that Jesus knows your struggle, he identifies with your pain, and he's overcome it all. And as he restores us to follow him, we can faithfully live out the commission that he gave to his disciples, and I believe he wants to give to us this day. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. Now, I want us to think about how it is that he is calling us specifically to be involved in the advancement of his kingdom and his purposes. First, it's for us. How are we walking with Jesus in a way that his Spirit is able to change who we are? Second, how are we influencing the people around us that God has entrusted to us and our friends and our family so that they know? Some of us are really busy with parenting and homeschooling and work, and thinking about doing something else just doesn't feel like it's possible. Take care of the things that are on your heart in front of you, because those are the things that are on God's heart. And then be open to how it is that God wants to use you in the places that you are, in your families, in your communities, the vocations that you have, the voice that you have, the standing in society that you have, to speak on behalf of those that can't speak for themselves, to stand with those that need your support and your strength. And as we're sent out into this world, as Jesus was sent into it, we recognize that we are plan A for the advancement of the kingdom, taking Jesus's message of forgiveness and salvation so that this place that isn't the way it's supposed to be will be made different and people would experience through us the love, grace, and goodness of Jesus. Amen? I can't hear you. Just kidding. Amen. At this time, we're going to move into a time of communion. So if you guys need to kind of run to the kitchen, run to the bathroom, I suppose, run to the kitchen, grab some bread, a cracker, juice, or wine, you should probably do that now. Okay, that's all you get. Just kidding. Communion really is a sacred time. And one of the things I do miss is taking communion together as a body. You know, I think doing this together as we are is an important thing, and especially as we remember that we're all part of the same family. We're all part, literally part of God's body. And so I want us to take a second as we prepare our hearts to think about this being a sacred time with other people, even though we're sitting kind of on our own. It's also providential because we're taking communion this day, today, and allowing this particular passage to speak to us. When Jesus is wrestling with the very thing that we are remembering today, his death on the cross, his body broken, his blood shed for the forgiveness of sins, the cost that he paid for the forgiveness and enabling us to have relationship with our Creator. The account that we read this morning comes right after the account we're going to read right now when the Last Supper occurs. Matthew 26:26, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." We're not going to do that, by the way, right now, yet. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. We do this," as Paul adds, "in remembrance of him." And before we take those elements, I want us to take a moment kind of to prepare our hearts to pray silently, and I'll tell us when we're going to do that, and to take a moment to pray silently, maybe to confess, maybe to repent, maybe it's to lament and cry out to God in your pain and your hurt, to sit with the one who has known deep anguish and heartache, and out of his love for you, paid for the sins of the world. And then I would challenge you to ask him to reveal to you how he wants you to respond to what you've heard today and what he's been stirring in your heart. And then after we take a moment in silent prayer, then I'll instruct us, you know, to take the elements. Lord, we open up this time so that we may come before you in reverence, along with our brothers and sisters who are listening, as one family and one body, so that we may confess, that we may repent, that we may sit with you, and that you may reveal to us how you would want us to respond. Amen. At this time, however you guys are arranged in your living rooms or wherever you are, go ahead and take the elements, the bread that represents his body broken for you, and the cup that represents the blood of the New Testament poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. pray as we close our time here. Lord, we're grateful that we can come to you in whatever shape we are. We confess that as disciples, your followers, we find ourselves in difficult times and ask you hard things. We thank you that you are a God who knows our hearts, that you know our anxious thoughts, who restores us and leads us in the way of everlasting. In Jesus' name.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
As we close our time here today, I would invite you to pray with me. Father in heaven, Lord, we acknowledge that you are God and creator of this universe. Lord, we find ourselves at a time in history that is extremely challenging. And Lord, we ask that you would be present with us this week. Lord, we recognize that it feels like it's requiring more than we have to offer. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to be present with us in our pain, in our anger, in our struggle, even just to do daily things. Lord, we need you. And like John says, that without you, we can do nothing. And so we recognize, Lord, our need for you and invite you. We also invite you to send us into this world to be light in darkness, to reflect your goodness and your character in everything that we say and everything we do. Help us to be mindful of your presence as we go out and advance your kingdom purposes here in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys for joining us this morning. I hope it was good for you as it has been for my soul. A couple of announcements as we close. There is going to be a virtual ministry community gathering for those people that are committed to Lighthouse and want to support what's going on in our ministry. Actually, everyone's invited, but it will be Sunday, June 28th from 12:30 to 2. We're going to also set aside time to answer questions and discuss issues that you might have. So if you would please submit your questions to Mei Ling by Sunday, June 14th, that would be greatly appreciated. At 11:15, right after the service ends here, we're going to invite you to join us for a time of prayer as we seek God's healing and restoration in light of recent times. So if you guys could look for the Zoom link invitation in the chat box, or it'll also be on our website. Thank you guys for joining us. Have a great day.